About video, video taking and the need for your consent to videotape the speakers, but some of you may not want to be in that film, so we'll talk about that later. And after we go through it, maybe one or two more people will be coming, and then we have a round of introductions so everybody can say who they are, where they're from, and what they do. So before I start this, I should present myself. So I'm Juan Guinosar from both the Technion, which is Technical University in Israel, just like here, and from Balonchips. Balonchips is a company that makes red hard processors for space, and that's what we do in this project. MaxSpace is a research and development project funded in the framework of FP7, Framework Program 7, by the European Commission, and in the scope of the space programs. It started in 2013, and we are just about to finish. The project has these seven participating companies. Seven, correct. Robotchip is the company I formed. DSI is here from Germany, and I guess how Professor Kalik will present it later on. SIVA is both in Northern Ireland and Israel. And a guy who is with me here from the company who presented. This is Tim Butright, right here. And Thales Arena Space, especially the Italian branch, David Fiore will be coming later today, and he will present that company. Presto is electronic testing for France. We don't have a speaker for the company here. And Antique is the management company, and Daniel is from Antique. She will say something about the company. So that was a 2.5 million euro project spread among the participants. And the project had all these goals, and we hopefully achieved most of them. So, of course, BASIC is a technology, and it started with a radiation hardening technology for space, for operation satellites, and so on. But this is just the background. Tomorrow I'll be talking about what this means. Then the processor that we will be describing and working on in this time. And next is a computer made of the processor, maybe multiple processors. And Ole from TSI will talk about this a little bit tomorrow. And the software that comes with it. System software such as compilers and kernel runtime system and so on. And the next thing is applications. What it is to be used on. What are the things you can use it for? And in this project, we have a bunch of use cases that will be described both from by Jamie Geert and from Tubes and from Tilo Bradwright and by David from Thales Arena Space. The bottom line that the question that we are supposed to answer is the evaluation. Is it good? Does it do what it promises? Does it execute the applications and achieve the performance that is expected and so on? Should it be used later on? The next part of your report is this evaluation. Tell everybody, and we have been doing presentations and conferences and papers and so on. And this summer school is part of it because our work is not important unless everybody knows about it. What's not written here up to this point is the fact that the European project has been great for us because it gets people from different organizations that do not usually work together to get to know each other and to build collaboration. So for us, it's been great because with this kind of collaboration, we got to know the other companies and the university we are connected to and create potential for continued collaboration in the future. And that leads to the last one, exploitation. And exploitation is a question that has to be answered within the project, but it relates to everything that happens after the project ends. So the question is, what will happen to the products generated during the project? The products are research products, are not really a commercial product, but what will happen afterwards? Will people use it after this is finished? And the summer school should also contribute to that, but basically it's the question that each and every one of the participants listed up here needs to answer themselves and also answer to the European Commission as we conclude the project or so out of the project. So the European project has always been great, and this one has been extremely useful because at the end we had seven participants in different countries and so on, all working in harmony toward an agreed upon goal together. So we liked it very much. And the end result, of course, is that we continue applying for the project. We don't always win, but it's a very nice project. One of them we did win, and Johnny will probably speak about that tomorrow, I guess. So just give us a glimpse. So what's in the program? We have a three-day program. The first day is more of a symposium because we have an overview, set of overview lectures and a panel at the end of the day. So after this welcome interview, we still have a few minutes. So the original schedule is all the way to 10, but I don't think we'll need up to 10 for that. Then we have a talk by Professor Paolo Micali from both QBarnsWhite and DSI about why does the space industry need something high-performance computing like Max Planck is supposed to do. Dan Kagai from SIVA will talk about their digital signal processors, which were not originally designed for space, but what they do and how they were adapted to this project. Then Professor Ladan Lokovich, who's not here yet, will talk about space computing research in the university here, not just within the scope of Max Planck, but a little bit expanded. After lunch, it says Giovanni is here, but he had to urgently go to other parts of Tarsalina space, so David Fiori, who's working with him, is coming instead, and he will talk about what they do in Tarsalina space for high-performance DSP. As you know, Europe, as far as the space industry is concerned, is divided into two prime contractors, Airbus and Tarsalina space, and then all the other companies. And Tarsalina space is one of the biggest in the world. They make about 10 different satellites every year, which is a lot of a lot for most big ones. And then I will talk again about future payload data handling systems in DSI. And we'll end up with a panel. Of course, there are coffee breaks and lunches in between. And we'll end up end up with a panel where all the speakers will discuss several items down here and also try to entertain other questions. So do not withhold any questions. Do ask them immediately if you want to, but also try to collect hard questions towards the end of the day, and we will try to confront the hard questions later on in the day. And if there are not enough hard questions from the audience, then we will invent our own hard questions. But it's better if you ask it. Give us some surprise. So tomorrow, this is a half day of tomorrow. The next slide is the other half. We start last weekend by a general introduction to high performance, parallelism, medical computing, some new terminology and general directions, and overview. And then I'll go into Max Payne's architecture. What is the architecture that, of the processor that we do and why? And continue with something completely different, how we make space components. The technology. So there are spaces about radiation effects, but also about environmental effects, thermal and mechanical issues, and what we have done in technology to do this. And this has nothing to do with high-performance computing. It has everything to do with how you build space component and you make sure that they are operating properly at the end by going through screening and qualification and other stages that are required as standards. And also speak a little bit about the part of space that doesn't really want to hear about standards, the low cost of space, where standards are sometimes pushed aside. And what happens when that takes place. In the afternoon, I'll go into what the interfaces are, how this one chip talks to the rest of the world, whether it's a second chip like this next to it, or whether it's just input and output and other interfaces. Ole Bishop from ESI, we talk about boards and how you build systems out of it, and describe different boards, and what are the considerations, and this is the main work that they've done at ESI, also related to software budget now. And Giovanni, duly represented by David Fiorin, we talk about the benchmarks. Some of the benchmarks that they have done and use cases, mostly about FFT and quantizations and so on, and to be followed by Jan right here, who will talk about EO is Earth observation, so it's imaging applications and both optical and radar, and he will talk about that. And Yamin has also made the micro benchmarks, and he will explain what they are and how successful it was. And that concludes the second day tomorrow. Then on Tuesday, on Thursday, the third day, we have three parts. The beginning will be Hagai again talking about the specific core, DSP core that we have inside the Max Payne and how different it is from just normal CPU like an ARM and why. And then all the pink colored is section of the highlights where we have a tutorial. Everybody will have their laptops, and I think all the cards are in, or no, not yet. We didn't bring the card, we're waiting for Yad. Yeah. Okay, so one more person from Montrose is coming later today, and he will bring little cards with our USB stick basically, and with the simulator, and everybody will put it on their machine. It's a virtual box or a virtual machine that you don't really have to install. You just copy and it operates. like the Eon machine, creates its own Linux environment within on your laptop, but disconnected from everything else on the laptop. So it doesn't interfere, no damages your laptop. It could be anything on the Mac, or Linux machines, or whatever. And then we run exercises, and the same virtual machine already includes all the exercises, all the codes, and so on. So we don't really write code from scratch, but we basically use and modify existing code, and we understand how programming Mako looks like. And at the end of the day, we summarize, and I don't know what we'll do in the summary, but we'll probably have a lot of discussion. And of course, we will be highly interested in hearing your feedback on anything and everything you've heard here. And we plan to be done by 5 o'clock in the afternoon on Thursday. So, before we go on to other explanations, here that Ole has just arrived. Hi, Matthew. Why don't we go into a round of introduction where everybody describes their name and where they're from and why they're here and what they do, what's their interest now. As much of a switcher as you want, we have these name placards so everybody can know who everybody else is, and it's I hope it's very useful. Part of the idea is to get to know other people as well.
We are the company that provided MaxBase the DSP, the digital signal processor. So I will focus. So this is what MaxBase or RC64 look like. So this one already, it's more flow of the task scheduler, how jobs are being sent to the MaxBase and how they are being processed and then being delivered with a result. And this is more block diagram, and what is interesting here is that basically what MaxBase project implemented is a big chunk of a lot of processors. Of every P here is represent of a processor or a DSP. And Ziva provides the DSP for the MaxBase. Mainly I will discuss that DSP today. Features and things like that. Later on I will discuss, so the DSP name is 1643. There is a reason behind this name. We'll talk about it. Then I'll briefly explain what we did for the MaxBase project in order to support the special needs of this application. Then I'll discuss briefly about other Ziva IPs that may be suitable for applications, other space applications, and that's about it for today. So first of all, who is Ziva? I think that many of you never heard about this name, about this company. So Ziva is a market leader in the terms of DSP IP, and by IP we mean intellectual property. Ziva provides the technology, and companies, our customers are mainly ASIC chip vendors, take the technology embedded on their silicon and goes to tape-out. Tape-out is the process where you manufacture the chip and then inform the design into real silicon. And then they go and sell it to the market. Normally you go to the market, you make silicon when there is a huge amount of chips being sold, for example in cell phones or things like that, where you sell, the thumb rule here is if you sell more than 1 million units of chips per year, then you should consider going into ASIC, going to make your own chip. So Ziva is a market leader in terms of DSP IP, we are largely up beyond others. Since it started, Ziva's customer delivered more than 7 billion chips to the market. This is our technology, it's not only one, we have several product lines. So our technologies are being shipped in 33% more, about one out of three cell phones over the world, different types of technologies. We also are very strong in the market of Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, provide IP, intellectual property technology for Bluetooth and Wi-Fi. Also for imaging and computer vision, something this is a new area. It's really becoming starting to boom right now. And a lot of technology in audio and voice. So Siva is headquartered in Mountain View, California. Traded in the Nasdaq. We are licensing IP, so licensing in the field and explain a bit in the next slide. Since 1991, we have offices all over. Main R&D centers are in Israel, France, and UK. Other locations are in sales and support. So what we do, what is the thing that we do? We develop technology. And by technology, we mean in this aspect, a DSP, digital signal processor. We define the architecture, the instruction set, the peripherals, the interrupts, all the mechanisms we develop in-house. We develop also the software development tools, the environment that you will write, as you may write your program, your algorithm, and implement your algorithm. We develop the tools that will convert the C language into the assembly language that will run on the processor. And this is what we provide to our customer as what we call IP, intellectual property. Customer takes this IP, and of course this is not enough making a chip. You need also memories, you need IOs, you need other peripherals, and this kind of IP is being all integrated together, and there are tools that convert this digital design into a chip. And this is what the customer are doing. They are basically taking the IP. Companies like Samsung, Spreadtrum, it's a big company from China, Broadcom, now Vago, or half of it, Gone, LG, others are taking the technology and making chips, making ASIC out of it, and sell it to end customers who ship products with this technology. Some of our customers, customers out of the 300 that we have, and these are a very small amount of them, and some of the products that we that are shipped with Siva technology. I would like to highlight the Gear S2 and the Samsung S7, which are also have some our technology in it. Okay, so this was a bit marketing about what we do, and now let's explain what we provided to the market. What was our contribution? So what we provided is a DSP. This we named Siva X1643. The name, I'll explain the name. It's basically composed of three group of numbers, 16, 4, and 3. The 16 stands for the data type that is being used, meaning all the data types are 16 bits. Normally when you work with the Mac, Mac is multiplied unit, it's the basic unit of a DSP. Normally DSP is good in doing a lot of multiply accumulate operations, and with that you can do any functions, any mathematical functions. So most DSPs are being measured, or one of the measurements are with how many max you have, how many multiply accumulate units you can do in one cycle, or units you have. So the 16 bit is the data type size that is entered into this Mac. Two 16-bit operands are being multiplied and accumulated, and the result is 32 bits. Now, it's important to say that we are talking about in this processor, and this is something that we enhance later on in MacBase, We are talking about floating point, fixed point processor. So in fixed point, the more you process the number, the larger the result has been, the larger is the result. As opposed to floating point, where you can keep the same size of the result. So so the result here is something that we enhance later on in MaxSpace. So the 16 is the data type, 4 is we have 4 multiply accumulate units in the processor. This means that in every cycle the processor can execute 4 multiply accumulate operations. I mean, it can compute, it can process 8 16-bit numbers and do 4 multiply accumulate operations into 4 bit results. This means that also all these 16-bit numbers are coming from the memory. This means quite large memory bandwidth to the local memories. So the next one is, the first bullet is this is the DSP is a VLIW CMD DSP processor. VLIW stands for very large instruction version, which means that the instruction that is being sent to have been executed by the processor is very large and composed from small instructions that each of them is being sent to a different functional unit. We have 8 functional units in the processor. And basically, we can compose an instruction, an assembly instruction that will execute, that will target all those functional 8 functional units, and hence we can, in one cycle, we can activate all those functional units. I'll show in a bit, in the next slide, what are the functional units. So this is a very high level of computation. SIMD stands for single instruction multiple data. We can process in a single instruction, a lot of data, different operands. So this is another thing that how this is powerful. This can reach in certain geometries, certain technology libraries, up more than 1 GHz. In the technology that we use, that MaxSpace is using, is 55, right? 55 nanometer. 65, but it's optic shrink or something. 65. So in 65, we reach a different number, but basically, with the relevant technology, we can reach up to 1 GHz. It's very energy efficient. We have a special unit, and I will talk about it later, that enables the processor to save power. Means that whenever an instruction or whenever there is a functional unit that is not needed at a certain cycle, we know how to not operate. So this means that not everything is working all the time, and this is how you can save some power when operating the DSP. As I mentioned, we also provide the software development tools. They are all being developed in-house. So since we develop everything in-house, we know how to tweak and how to compile the code very efficient from the C level into the assembly that runs on the DSP. So few words on the block diagram. Main thing here is this is the heart of the DSP. We have 4 computation units or 4 multiply accumulate units, all named M01, MS, and ML. Any of them can execute multiply accumulate. So we have 4 of these. We have 3 units that basically handles the data transfer to the data memory. So we have 2 load store units, so we can target 2 different locations from the memory. So for example, you can take data from one area in the memory, process it, and send it to a different area of the memory. And this way you can do those things, read and write, on the same cycle. So you are not bound by the vast to the memory. We also have a scalar unit here, which The main role is to process the pointers to the memory very fast if you need to do some post modification, some operations on the address. So we have here another three units, total here 4.37. Another one is the unit that handles interrupts, branches, and exceptions. So this is another unit. Total of 8 instructions in one cycle can be run on this processor. Besides the DSP, the core, the heart of the DSP, we have data memory subsystem, which composed of cache control, ASI support, write buffer to the data memory outside and the local memory, some arbiters. Those memories are composed from few blocks and banks, and you don't want that two sources will access the same physical memory, so you need to implement arbiter that will know which one will access the memory on a certain cycle. So this is in terms of the data memory. In terms of the program memory, we divide the data locally. All those data memories, those yellow green ones, are local memories, meaning you can access them in zero latency. You don't have any latency going through the memory, as opposed to external memories, which are, you have some penalty when accessing them. You have, for example, in this DRAM, you have a first cycle to the memory. Typical numbers are 50 cycles to get the first access from the memory. So here, the local memories, the one that are close to the DSP, are zero latency. Operates very fast. Program memory, we have a cache controller, arbiters, and also an ASI. The need for the ASI is to fetch the program from external source. We have a cache controller, so whenever you have a hit, you go outside, fetch the relevant instruction, relevant code into the local memory. So the memory, you can also work from external memory, but there are things to work. We also have an emulation. This is the way that you can communicate your PC or your hardware, you communicate with the DSP for debug purposes. And we have an APP port, then what we call the power scan unit, the unit that controls power, clock, shutdown, in order to conserve power. So, highlights of the DSP are, as I mentioned, we have quad MAC, quad being 4 multiply accumulate units, 32, all the programming model is 32 bits, meaning that the address map is 32 bits, which means that you can access up to 4 gigabytes of space. You can run up to 8 independent instructions. Single execution units, meaning that you can run single instruction on multiple data. We have operations that work on word or byte, so you can run 8 byte or 8 word operation in single cycle. 4 multipliers, and which enables us to run 4 accumulate operations in a single cycle. And if you make use of those 4 units, you can implement one complex multiplication, one complex MAC in a single cycle. Because in order to implement a complex MAC, you need to do 4 multiply accumulate operations. And the code density is something very important in order to keep the code size small. It's composed of a blend, a mix of 16 and 32 bit instructions. So, such as the most common instructions are mapped to 16 bits, and the rare ones are mapped to 32 bits. So, this keeps the code very compact and small. We have the DSP instruction set, what we call ISAC, instruction set architecture, composed of multiply accumulate, shift operation, bit manipulation, exponent, min max operations, FFT support, and Hyperbian filtering mechanisms, byte support for video algorithms, and we can handle different data types from 8 to 40 bits. We have large register file, 24 orthogonal accumulators. This is important because in order for the compiler to work with all the operations that it needs and to reduce the usage of storing data on the stack, on the memory, and then reading it back. So the more registers that you have, the more accumulators that you have, the compiler can play with it and then work on the instruction very efficiently. And we have also 8 addressing registers. This is very important if you need to access different locations in the memory and you don't want to save or change the addresses all the time. Dual load store units means that you can access for read and write on the same cycle. Important if you're working on different numbered bit buffers and want to read and write and operations on the same time, without in for one cycle to read and then another cycle to write. Very important. Data memory bandwidth is 128 bits. This is needed in order to support bringing all the data to the 4 multiple accumulate units on every cycle. So we need this quite relatively high or large memory bandwidth in order to feed the multiple accumulate units every cycle. Okay, we talk about the vector calculation, one cycle for 4 multiple accumulate units, min-max instructions. In all of the acceleration here, it talks about 1 to 2 cycles for complex FFT butterfly and single cycle for a return decoder. We have we can support 2 add compress select, which is the basic of perturbing in every cycle. We have split operations that can work on 2 words or 4 bytes, depends on the data types of the operation that you need, the data type that you're working on. And as mentioned, 40 bit accumulators. We need 40 bits and not 32, because when you multiply 2 numbers, 2 16 bit numbers, the results always needs to be more than 32 bits. So the additional 8 bits above 32 is what we call guard bits, to save you can sum more numbers over the time. Okay, so that was the DSP core. Now we'll talk a bit about the cache memory, data cache memory. The data cache is a two-way set-assertive cache. Can have dual core accesses at the same time. It's per block. Software invalidates, you can invalidate the cache. Meaning you can clear the content of the cache. For example, when you start working on different function, or at the beginning of the world when you wrap up the chip, you can lock the cache or unlock the cache. Cache locking is important in case you have some critical function on the memory and don't want it to be flashed out, you want it to save, because you all the time keep using it. And if, for example, you need to work on something else, you don't want that specific area of code or the data to be flashed out. So you can lock the cache. LIU cache replacement policy is recently used. We support both write from the copy back, or either working on the cache or working outside. Write buffer to prevent eviction from stalling, meaning whenever you store a number on the memory, it doesn't be stored automatically outside. There is a write buffer in order to ease the connectivity to the memory. It also helps in terms of connectivity to the memory in terms of the speed. Slave port for TCM memory. We have 2 buses of AXI. One is, for example, whenever the core needs to read the data from an external source, from the SDRAM, flash memory, some external memory from a different processor. It uses the AXI master bus because the core is the initiator. So it is the master that is asking for the data from the other source. We have another bus that's called AXI slave in case the core is being slave. Someone is asking about the memory content inside the core, inside the memory. So it can support that one. And as mentioned, since we have a 32-bit address bus, so we can support up to 4 gigabyte space of unrestricted data space or address bus. PowerScale, this is the unit that has two roles. One of them is to make sure that a unit function that is not being used will not get an enabled signal and you can save power. Another usage is where with a certain circuitry outside of the DSP, you can shut down certain areas on the DSP. For example, if you want to keep the core in sleep mode and say and make the memories alive, you want to use them because the data is important, but currently the DSP is not being used, you can turn off the DSP and keep the memories alive with the power source. So we have different types of operations of how to support that, and this is of course needed. You need to have something outside, some external circuitry, because the core will give you the indications when things can be shut down, but someone needs to shut it down physically outside. The core cannot shut its power supply by itself. You need to have some external mechanism to do that. So this is basically what this power scaling unit does. We have different types of operation. In case you need the core to be clocked, and the memories to be shut down, or different types of this mechanism. In terms of the memory management, we have the memory control unit. This one we already mentioned that it's for the AXI and the cache controller. Other things is the base address. We have a different type of page size, meaning the PC can support different types of memory sizes, all the way from 16 kilobyte up to 4 megabyte. And we have an L1 data cache. Cache policy is write-write copyback, as I mentioned. And two memory orders, one is total stop ordering and strong ordering, meaning either the instructions or the store transactions that are being sent out are being exited or being sent as is. The AXI bus supports out of the order transaction, meaning that if the bus is not ready, you can send a later transaction before an earlier transaction. Depends on the bus structure and the bus availability. So in some cases this is irrelevant. You don't care which transaction to which slave is being sent, but in some cases you want to make sure that the order that you send the transaction is being kept. You want to make sure that the stack slave will get that peripheral will get the data transaction on a certain order. So we support both operation, either with order, strict order, which is called strong ordering, or total stop ordering, whatever is sent out, this is what the AXI bus standard supports. We also have hardware prefetch, meaning that if you need the record, the DSP sends what data you need to bring in, and does the relevant operations want to bring it before it is needed. Besides the DSP itself, what we talked until now was the hardware of the DSP, the very low, the mechanism, the architecture. Besides that, we also provide software development tools. We develop the tools in-house. It's called the Siva Toolbox. We support all the needed tools like a simulator, an assembler, linker, a debugger, profiler, compiler, of course. We provide two ways of simulator, cyclic count simulator, and instruction sets. Of course, the instruction set is faster because we don't simulate all the DSP states every cycle. Just make sure that the instruction, you simulate the execution of the instruction, but also support cyclic count, cyclic accurate simulator, where you know on every, this is the most closest one to a real to build a silicon or real machine to know every cycle, what is the status of the machine, what are the content of the register, what is the content of the memories, the load programmers, and all the internal registers. So we support that. We provide also optimized library, different functional libraries, for example, BSP libraries, where we implement FFT, FIR, Cortex FIR, very efficient on the DSP, so we provide the functions optimized to the DSP, so we don't need to rewrite them already. They are all being optimized to the DSP. Profiling, where you should know where the DSP spends most of the speed cycles, and then you know where to optimize your code. There's another nice tool called Project Optimizer, which is a tool that, since we support compiling per function, some function, and we have levels of compiler, either towards code size or towards cycle count, you can activate this tool and it will run, compile the code in different optimization levels for every function. At the end of this process, it will give you a map of what the best configuration of the compiler. For example, function A, it is better to focus on cycle count and less on the code size. And this is the way you can get a graph where you have several spots, several areas where you have more towards the code size or more towards the cycle count. And by clicking it, you can implement it to your project and run it on the compiler, so you don't have to guess what function it needs to be run on.
Nice, okay. So, welcome you to my presentation today. As first part, I will introduce you a little bit into our activities at Team Braunschweig. And in our group, which is the BSI Systems Group at ITUS. I'm not sure if Harald has already shown Team Braunschweig.
No.
Okay, so these are some slides about Team Braunschweig to give you an idea. So, we are actually 40,000 students. 3,000 university staff, 1,600 scientists, 5 departments, but okay, actually it's more because we merged them, and we have around 40 degree programs. So what's interesting is that we are one of the oldest polytechnic in Germany, founded in 1745. And this has been the school where Karl Friedrich Gauss had actually gone through his education. So I'm not such an expert in Gauss, maybe Harald knows more about this, but as far as I know, he had a scholarship from the local duke. So this was an independent dukedom or whatever country. It was a duke on the boss, and the duke gave scholarships to talented young people, and one of them was Gauss actually. And so then he went to the Academia, started also his career at Team Braunschweig, but then the Polytechnic in Braunschweig. But then he moved on to Göttingen. He got a full professor position at Göttingen, which was somehow more prestigious at that time, and was well known university. So. But he did a lot here locally, so in this area he worked a lot on actually geodetic stuff, so triangulation, this kind of things. You can find everywhere Gauss points when he was trying to triangulate in the area. So we are a member of TU9, which is a collection of technical universities, former polytechnics in Germany, which were founded after the original France, after Napoleon left Germany. Then the small countries founded their own polytechnics. So there's Braunschweig, you might have already realized when you came here. And what is interesting here, you see R&D in Europe, and this is the percentage of GDP spending per region in R&D. So this gives you an idea about R&D intensive regions in Europe, and not so R&D intensive regions. Yeah. And you see in Germany, there's actually Norway in the south, which is not very surprising, but in the north actually we have a few hotspots, and one of them is Braunschweig.
What is the number of 7 there?
7% of GDP is region goes to R&D. It's quite high. Mm-hmm. So there is a reason for this. So we actually located here also. My group has around 15 research staff members. And this is the, if you look at what we have here, Braunschweig, our technology area. So we have a Siemens train systems. There is a large automotive company nearby, but it's also actually has a large plant in Braunschweig. And and we have also large institutes from the DLR, actually in Braunschweig, and the PTB, so the Mechatronic Center of Germany. Yeah, there it is. Yeah. Actually, Intel is unfortunately gone. Yeah. But the group is still there, but it's remained. It's another company now. And we have some also federal biological research centers in microorganisms. So the German Microorganism Center is in extremely important. Two former institutes. And there is a, okay, aviation security group, actually next to the DNR.
Oh, they I think. Who she called this, who's invented this CRISPR-Cas method for microbiology, was Elizabeth Carpentier, I think she was.
So actually, next to Gauss, the new star from this region, is actually a French lady.
Yeah.
I don't know if you heard about CRISPR-Cas, it's in biochemistry. It's a new method to cut genes and DNA sequences. And so, this lady, after graduating from Institut Pasteur, she actually was in Braunschweig, Hanover region for some time, until very recently actually, and I think 1 or 2 years ago, after the discovery of CRISPR-Cas, she's a shooting star in biochemistry. Yeah? She for sure will get the Nobel Prize. And she accepted the director position in Berlin for Max Planck on, I don't know, biochemistry, whatever. Tja, too bad. Huh? So she's still in Germany, but she recently left Braunschweig. What's her name?
Elizabeth Carpentier.
Yeah. She also, there is also a new prize, it's an innovation award in California, Silicon Valley Innovation Award, 10 million or so. She received this already, and for sure she will get the Nobel Prize. CRISPR-Cas is extremely high impact innovation and extremely successful. Just move for CRISPR-Cas. It's a gene skisser system. Yeah. Okay, let's go on. So this is basically our research in our group. So we have our background. My background is hardware-based accelerator, so a little bit related to DSP, what we've seen before. We are doing some space-borne computing activities. I will show later. We work on energy efficiency and many core image processing, system design and virtual platforms, and we have also small activity in robotics. So this is our group, how it's organized. Next to me there is Yami, who you already know. Oops, I don't know, it's not really we have an enlarged medical computing group led by Dr. Rainer Bukti, and for robotics, Jörn Zucker actually lead this activity. This gives an idea of our project partners. It's mainly from European projects. Some of them make space in QI2S. I don't know why this is automated before, but okay. Nee, das geht gar
nicht.
No, no, I don't know. This is a bizarre. Okay, so funded projects. This is just at the European level. We have also some local projects which are not included here, some industry projects. So, starting with FP7, we had, actually it was one of the last FP7 projects across Europe. We have QI2S, which is successfully finished last year, which was actually based already on DSP design and together with run on chips. We were looking at image interpretation as a successor project. There was a mixed space, which we will hear a lot coming days, which is on DSP protocol. Our activities are actually on the DSP prototyping and development for micro satellites. And then the new one is, some of you know it already, S3Net, where we are the coordinator, where we are working on satellites, warm sensor networks. So it's also about onboard payload processing, but in this case, the idea is to have it distributed, in order to get some kind of fractionated and distributed sensor for Earth observation. Also, there is an activity of interfacing and communication between these, of course, swarm sensor satellites. I will talk about this later. We have actually two ESA projects, European Space Agency. One is called SOC Rocket. Sorry, I don't know. Tell me, do you know how to stop this? There's some auto forward in this presentation.
Right thing?
Very nice. Okay, good. So SOC Rocket is a virtual cross platform for multiprocessor system on chips. So the idea is ESA is sponsoring key development for their future payloads and also microelectronics components. And here there is a new trend in recent years coming from mobile phones. I think SEVA uses it already since they are from the mobile phone business. To have an idea to make software prototypes of your digital hardware systems, and the ESA wanted to copy this also for their onboard payload processors, and we won this contract and wrote this model. I will talk a bit later more about this model in detail, but the basic idea is to have fast system simulators. Another one we had from ESA was a CFTP project, which is on satellite communication protocol. So this is a hardware software module or component to implement this CFTP protocol. And we have also system C model to use it for future prototyping. Okay, this is this project, so it's called CCDS File Delivery Protocol or CFTP. It's an ESA project, so the idea is to have a delay tolerant file delivery protocol, something like FTP for space. So, and in this case, a hardware software component was developed, which allowed for configuration parameters to in a wide range to adapt to the needs of communication, and also to implement a reliable file transfer for remote file system management over interplanetary distances, so long delay communication. So we wanted to implement it for space tolerant ASIC FPGA, sorry. And the features actually should support unreliable sender and receivers. So files and user messages should be delivered, and of course we have things like CRC, checksum, and 464K packet size, 4GB file size. So now we do the details for the performance. Originally was targeting the Euclid mission, so it should be in the range of 850 GHz per day, 75 GHz downlink, or next generation mass memory, average 1 to 5 GHz. So there is a wide range of configurability and variability of the core. We wanted to have different CCSDS encapsulation formats, a generic file store interface, so not a file store, but a generic file store interface. And of course also tool implementation. So this is how it looks like. So we started with a definition feature, hardware software partitioning. Then we actually designed such a high-level system C prototype in order to play around with it, to see what can be used. And from this we derived an actually a real hardware implementation using the HDL, and also made an SEE, so an error mitigation plan based on the Neon 2FT system. Then we did a validation and mapped it to a raster system platform. And finally, there was also synthesis experiments with different FPGA platforms. So looking into detail, this is the architecture of the CFTP. You see different blocks. So ideally, so the NONA should work together with a Neon 2 host processor, yeah, assisted for acceleration. And there's actually several levels of hardware support. You have the management information base containing the configuration. Then there is a transaction manager with a context, a transaction processor that is actually autonomously doing the transactions. And at the physical layer, you have a PDU serializer, deserializer, and an encapsulation service that then actually runs the transmission autonomously. And this functions as shown here. So the transaction processor gives the data to the PDU serializer, which then actually has a hardware support for encapsulation, data transfer via FIFO, then it goes to a bus, which then is connected to some sending device, and the vice versa on the receiver side. So this IP was developed in system C to be able to early software driver development, to evaluate the architecture early, to measure performance, and we did also some design space exploration. And this was then integrated with Soft Rocket platform, shown here. So this gives us an idea about the Soft Rocket. This is the other project we have with ESA. The Soft Rocket is actually a model of the, let's say, of space-based control system or control board. So we have a Leon instruction set simulator, and this is a Copenhagen with an AHP bus, together with most needed peripheral, and all this can be simulated as a virtual platform. Now you ask yourself, okay, why do you need a virtual platform if I have a, I don't know, an instruction set simulator? Huh? The problem is the instruction set simulator only simulates instructions of your system. But for your control system, you also want to model, let's say, interfaces. For example, the CFTP protocol. And then you need, of course, access to your I/O modules. And these have to be modeled on a register base, and this is actually here. So you have the whole bus system also, it's more accurate. And you have also the I/O, the drive, device driver software can also be measured with this. Yep. Okay. So the next question is, okay, but you could do this also using maybe some compiled or embedded Verilog code. This is of course possible, it's also more precise than this here, but it's very slow. Verilog is extremely slow, and with this system you have a much higher performance. And actually we use this Soft Rocket as a basis to integrate the CFTP and to make some experiments, to make some design decisions, which actually was successful. Yeah, and this shows what we did. So so we could quickly integrate the bus interfaces and the registers in the Soft Rocket, and we could also already implement the software so that we could boot the RTEMS OS on it. And so this was a prototype that was actually done using Soft Rocket, where we checked, okay, what about the performance and this configuration, if the Leon is connected to this core using one single AHP bus and then ATV bus. So the ATV bus is just for the control registers, yeah, okay, IRQ is for feedback, and the data is actually from the transaction processor and encapsulation is connected by an AHP bus. And this was then to do the demo system where we used actually just the memory and the space wire for mass storage. And then we did some performance evaluation using the virtual platform. And it was obvious that this single AHP bus actually was the bottleneck. Then we came up with a more ambitious solution where we used several AHP buses. So for receiving and transmitting actually. So we used separate buses. Shown here, yeah, and we have one more bus for the control system. Yeah, shown here. Okay, to summarize the CFTP project, so it's an enhanced system architecture based on several AHP buses, a master interface, a slave interface for transmitter and receiver, then there is another master file store request interface, and a slave file store response interface. So we have four AHP interfaces. And the benefits here is we have reduced access time and our interface option and more performance. So the next project we have is QI class. It's quickly that's the FP7 project. Quick image interpretation system based on the onboard bingo processing, and this shows the system, the idea for QI class. So actually there are several steps that need to be done, and I guess we will have more details in the future. So basically what is being performed is regulated code corrections, then we're doing the equation solving, and finally the idea is to have some target tracking. So this gives an idea about the radiometric corrections, sensor bias correction, charge transfer correction, gain and image registration. Here are the results shown, the processing before and after. You see we did some smoothing. And actually this was mapped on a processor that will be detailed within this course, the round chip parallel processor, which allows two levels of parallelism. And basically we have a 64 processor, ideally, the demonstrator had a little bit less, which can do 64 tasks in parallel, and this shows the task mapping. So it's where a system is shared memory. Finally, this gives you an idea about the algorithms we implemented or the verbal learning to address. So, several areas for the radiometric correction, then another of layers for the atmospheric, and finally all the detection. This was integrated into a real hardware prototype based on FPGA. This consisted of two parts, image processing and post. Yeah, and that was shown actually in October last year. Yeah, after that there was another project, NextSpace, which was looking into SIR, synthetic aperture radar benchmarks. And the application consists of range FFT, compression, azimuth FFT, range IFFT, azimuth compression, and finally azimuth IFFT. This is actually a benchmarking that was done on a normal x86 and where the numbers. Yeah, it took 47 seconds to compute this in double precision on a normal interface server. And this gives you a breakdown of the computations. I guess Yami will give you more details in this talk. And so, derived from the algorithms, this gives the target performance you want to achieve. So, okay, this includes radiation hardness, is of course a requirement for hardware, interface performance, power, 10 watt, clock frequency was 300 megahertz targeting, and yeah, so we calculated something around 40 gigaflops and 80 gigamics needed for the total computation, and then we looked into the roadmap of similar, let's say, space-based systems. This is shown here from 1985 to 2005 from literature, several implementations, and mixed space is actually turning the performance quite on the higher level when compared to the competition. So this one here, Maestro, is a system, is also a heterogeneous system that was designed by IBM and Tilera.
Maestro is the
Tilera-based processor for the Department of Defense and Aerospace Industry. And this is used in some commercial systems for radar surveillance. Yeah, this shows our prototype from MixSpace, which is finalized these days. Yeah? Now we'll show you more about this. Yeah, and finally we have S3Net, satellite small sensor network. It is looking into a set of sensors on different, let's say, satellites. Yeah? And the idea is to form some kind of a virtual instrument where these satellites should work together. Yeah? And then we, of course, have a lot of onboard processing requirements, but also the requirement of coordination and data transfer. And there we are actually looking also into the CFTP protocols for using it. Yeah. So far, potential application domains include tomographic configuration, bistating interferometry, or spectral configuration. So finally, to conclude, the focus is actually on accelerators for signal processing, communication, cryptographic applications. We have a couple of projects in the space systems domain, and here we are also focusing on high performance and giving up an energy efficient computing. That's it. Thanks. That was my last slide before lunch.
Okay, so maybe I can talk about one of these slides, of one of the performance slides that was regarding SAR. We currently estimate that Raman chips under 100% utilization, that's the assumption, can perform this SAR processing needed within a couple of seconds instead of a minute. The minute is, to be honest, it's not 100% fair comparison because we only took a look at single thread performance on an x86, but it's a new generation. Whereas on one hand this seems like an unfair comparison, on the other hand I have to say it's a fair comparison. We because if you take a look at the Lamont-Chips architecture, it is a single, I mean, one core is can only handle a single thread. And it's not a real SIMD kind of processor, it's a DLIW, so it can issue a couple of instructions per cycle. It's not a single issue, it's more like a multiple issue type of view. If you compare it now to one processor, one to one, this is more or less fair. On an x86, of course, you can utilize your SIMD and speed up things. But to assure you, we have employed FFTW on an x86, and the performance we got is within a minute time for this application. But on DSP, which is targeting mostly signal processing workloads like FFT and so on, we hope that on 100% utilization we can do even better than x86. We'll see if this turns out to be true. We'll know in the next couple of months. I think the goal of Ramon chips is quite ambitious. It's more or less, I mean, they won't be the next x86. x86 has way more features, can run operating systems and so on. But in terms of space computations, or computations in space, this is something really, really different. I mean, you currently in aviation, like how I had showed, people are using free-scale power processors, they use redundancy mechanisms, and so on, but in the end, if you use redundancy, you waste a lot of power. And Ramon-Chip's goal, I think, more or less, is to be not only in the high-performance segment, but also comparatively power-efficient to whatever is out there. You've seen it on the slides. It's expected, I mean, the RC64 is expected to use in the order of 10 watts power, which is far below any type of x86 computing. And you also have to put it into comparison, because even in your laptop, you have a processor that burns 45 watts, approximately, a few more or less. In an x86 server, your processor is burning 100 watts. Or if you go to the very high performance cores that we cannot match performance wise for sure, like a 16 core or 18 core processor, you are far beyond 100 watts and GPUs go to 300. So you are also on a system that is running autonomously, or more or less remote, completely on its own. There's no special power supply, yeah, that you can just utilize. There is only your solar cells. I mean, most European satellites are running on solar energy compared to the US ones that partially run on nuclear power. So you have a power limitation. For radar, less than for optical. In radar, you can also burn a kilowatt. In optical missions, not that much, because it's 100% passive. The solar deflectors are much smaller. So you have to save on power and space.
Yeah.
So I understood that this MaxSpace prototype was built around FPGA, so it implemented a fraction of what RC64 will be inside the FPGA. So could you elaborate a bit more on what are the differences, or what part has been actually implemented and characterized?
We got a simulator for the final system, yeah? So there's two things. There's a simulator for the final system where you can try the algorithms and get an idea of the performance, and there's a real FPGA demonstrator which is a bit downgraded, but okay, Jamin is actually doing the benchmark, so...
I don't want to take credit for
There's also at the moment we have the FPGA demonstrator, which Ole will show later on, and this will be extended to an ASIC platform, so with a board where the ASIC can be adapted. So this is the final goal of the MaxSpace project.
Okay, to have it in ASIC.
Yeah.
Yes.
But to have the basically RC64, or you are speaking
yes.
about the
some core on silicon.
Okay.
Forces.
And all the interfaces. That's the goal. The final goal of the project.
But at the moment I understand that this prototype, as it is implemented in FPGA, is full of features which FPGA bring, which is a high power consumption and relatively low speed.
What is the memory network, which is one of the core features of the Raman chips processor. It's a very special network, a RedMic network, that reduces the number of congestions by far. Because the question you always have is, can my processor sustain the computational performance if there is much traffic on the memory network? And this is a special network with less congestions. They have a lot of memory banks, 256. The order of magnitude, and they have logarithmic steps. So the number of bank conflicts due to the high number of banks is very low. And I mean, you have to design this network efficiently.
To present you a little bit what we are doing in both institutions. Here at UBS and also at DSI company, in terms of onboard processing, and discuss a little bit, talk a little bit where we see potential to use future MaxSpace processor in these kind of systems. So first, I will introduce you in our activities at. IAA, the Institute of Computer and Communication Engineering here at Medieval Braunschweig, where I'm residing. Then I like to introduce the activities related to data, space for data handling at DSI. And then I go into some current application examples. And as I said, we like to see. Show you where MaxSpace could help us for future applications and in conclusion. So first, the activities at IDA, TBS. What we're doing there is mainly related to implementing digital processing units for scientific instruments. this is one branch, and then it's a long-term cooperation with from Astro, now Airbus, and also with DSI, we have, due to our activities of validation testing of memory devices and other devices, we have a long history implementing semiconductor mass memory modules for space. And as an add-on to our instrument computers, the instruments are driven and operated by scientists typically. And in former times, we had always to deliver the software up to the application level. And physicists and scientists are nice guys, but they have a lot of ideas and it puts a lot of workload on you if you always implement their wishes in software. So we invented a kind of a middleware where they can easily write their own operational software. This is configurable behind the onboard software. Then I already addressed the radiation testing activities, and we are doing also smart systems for space robotics. In instrument EUs, we have a long history of processes for cameras and particle spectrometers. You see some of the project names there. This is typically in cooperations with scientific institutions like Max Planck here. 2000-2001 using FPGAs, SMM-based FPGAs. And we have implemented a lot of DPUs on that basis. For instance, for the so-called Venus monitoring camera, we did a very compact 8x8 centimeter and 3 centimeter high DPU with image compression in it, image mask analysis, and so on. We did a similar implementation on this for the Dawn mission. The Dawn mission is still active and went to Vesta and now is in service, and the discussion is to extend it to third object, another asteroid. It was quite successful there, and there we are using Xilinx FPGAs, putting our, this is the custom approach which I showed before. This is on instrument level quite acceptable. Also we achieved with some error mitigation schemes we have applied quite high availability. So these are not 100% failure-free, they are failure-tolerant, it's a failure-tolerant design, but for an instrument level, this is acceptable. these are some examples of mass memory modules we delivered up to the engineering model, and then in cooperation with other companies, they did flight models. Then for different missions, flash-based, SDRAM-based mass memories. So we have a kind of a history here from more than 40 years perhaps. the software aspect, as I said, it's kind of middleware. You use the traditional protocols, CCSDS communication protocols for telemetry and telecommand to send up observational programs. You have a system there running several virtual machines. You create a safe environment, and what you set up is kind of a script language. So it's a topo code, and the programming language is C-like, but it's more programming in like you are doing programming in MATLAB. And it's very high level. You have some library functions, and this is, I think, any physicist or technical guy can understand the program, so it's, they can do their own observational programs. It's not very fast because it's interpreted at one board, so it's not for implementing high-speed processing, but it's more the processing and the data acquisition control that's programmed there. And if you have dedicated processing tasks, then you use library functions or use hardware accelerators. we are doing navigation testing of memory devices and other digital devices like FPGA. We are doing these testings for customers like agencies, also for companies. We have a testbed which is adaptable to different devices, and most efforts also go into the device treatment before you can do testing, because the you have to go into for the testing to accelerators, and at least here in Europe, the energy that of the particles that the accelerators can provide is not very high, so the penetration depth of the particles is not very high. And if you want to test your semiconductor device, you have to decap the package. the best would be you get their dies from the companies, but most of the companies of commercial devices don't like that you test their devices evaluation-wise. So in most cases, you don't get the their dies. So you have to open the ready-made packages, and the modern devices are the high-integrated flip chip devices. And then again, if you open, you have the thick backside layer, which has to be thinned first before you can go, come with the beams to the active layer. So it's kind of an intricate thing, but we have a good process for that. We tested dynamics, FPGAs, and so on. So we would be in principle also able to test the MaxSpace processor. We're doing something in collaboration with Dartmouth Institute on space robotics, building up demonstrators for space robotics. So this is more or less what we're doing in IDA. At DSI, we have a strong focus on computers, mass memories, and processing units for space applications. We have also a branch with special computers like photography and communications, which are for space, but the emphasis is there more in general, aerospace, also for computers here, not only space. And then something around like test systems and engineering services. DSI is a SME company with about 50 engineers at the moment active in these fields. We have a lot of projects with payload computers, for instance, also we worked in the COBA project. There we get payload data handling, data compression, for instance. We have been active in radar systems. So this is a German military satellite constellation where we did the space and ground computer units. On Galileo we did some computer units for the ground. Exploration missions like ExoMars, where we did the design of the implementation, design and implementation of the payload data handling unit together with Airbus companies in collaboration. We do something quite small missions like this is an asteroid lander mission, Hayabusa, a Japanese mission. This is a German hyperspectral mission where we do instrument control and plasma later. And also, for instance, for a Turkish satellite, we did a special encryption. Some viewer. For instance, here I come to that later. Also, we have a dedicated mass memory system, smart mass memory system for Jupiter exploration mission, JUICE. The weather observation satellites METOP for a certain instrument, we do a special unit. S3NET has been addressed already. This is a Horizon 2020 project, and some others. This is again the SAR project where we do encryption. It's high speed encryption, it's really high database here. just as an overview. So, as application examples, I have kicked out of these various applications three or four examples, which I like to go into a little bit. First one is from IDA, from Institute. This is dedicated to the so-called solar orbiter fine instrument. This is a very special telescope observing the sun, and this mission will go here is 2017. This was the initial planning. At the moment is the launch plan for 2019. This is a special instrument, a pull-up meter, which observes the intention is to observe the dynamics and resolution of the magnetic field vectors on the sun's surface, looking into the sun's atmosphere in the X-ray and UV range, EUV, extreme UV range. And to do that, you do typical polarization measurements. So it's an imaging instrument. You have a polarimeter in front of the imaging instrument, so it produces a huge amount of data. There are several detectors in 2K by 2K detectors, and there are per minute a data set of 3.3 gigabit is generated there. So on the other hand, you have very constrained telemetry rate. This probe goes very near to the sun, 0.2 astronomical units, which is very close. And the telemetry rate that is dedicated to this instrument is something around 10 kilobit. This 100 megabit here is the rate from the instrument to the space probe. And then it's further slowed down, so to say, from the space probe to Earth. So in average, you can count for this instrument 10 kilobits per second. What does that mean? You produce a huge data set, 3.2 gigabit of images. It's a set of images in different polarization states. And then you have to bring that down to Earth. This is not possible to compress with the traditional image compressing schemes like JPEG 2000 or something like this. They get compression factors of, best case 10 or 20 or something like this. And then you lose too much of the original data. If you ask scientists, they would always have the raw data. So the only possibility is, like I showed you before, this QI2S, to do the inversion processing on board. And then you are directly at the end data products, and there you can apply on very higher level data compression. So for this inversion processing alone, you need a computing capacity of 30 gigaflops. There are some other functions, because the telescope observes a small fracture of the sun, and do a long-term observation. So you have to follow the hotspots, so we have an image stabilization system on it. So there are some other intricate processing tasks to be done, which come out of this 30 gigaflops. As I had shown you before, if you would like to use a space-proven but hard processor, it's not available, so we don't have MaxSpace at the moment, and we started this design in 2015. MaxSpace was far away in that time. So we decided to use our FPGA approach, the custom approach, which we had done in previous projects. We have a DPU, a processing unit, with a general controller, which is kind of this neon type, the GR712 here. Then we have a fixed burned FPGA for the general data flow control. And then we have two loadable FPGAs from Xilinx 4 FPGAs. And we use these FPGAs with dynamic reconfiguration, in orbit dynamic reconfiguration, for two purposes. First purpose is, we can afford, from power, mass, volume, only two FPGAs. We would need, in total, to cover all four FPGAs. What we are doing is, we reconfigure the two FPGAs during the image acquisition and the processing in two phases. One is serving the image acquisition phase. You see here the data acquisition from the detectors goes to one FPGA, and the other does this image stabilization algorithm. And then afterwards, we store the data in the image memory, own mass storage in that instrument. And afterwards, we reconfigure the FPGAs to do this inversion processing. So it's really dynamical reconfiguration. And the second point is, this inversion here is an algorithm that has been set up on the ideas of this new instrument. The fine-tuning of the algorithm is only possible when you do the first measurements of this new kind of instrument. So there is a quite high probability that the algorithm might be not sufficient when you do the first measurements. And it's not such that you tune one or two parameters. It may be, it's also a long-term version, may be necessary to exchange the complete algorithm. And if you do it like here, you can upload a new version of the algorithm to the space probe that takes the time. But you have
the possibility to upgrade your hardware.
Normally, you would do such a complex processing in a software implementation of the algorithm if you would have a nice processor. We don't have it, so we have to do it in dedicated hardware. And to keep the possibility for upgrading for the display configuration, we use these guidance FPGAs. So this is the new thing. I think it's the first time, really, at least in Europe, kind of dynamic reconfiguration and long-term reconfiguration is used in space. The inversion process itself, it's, as I said, it's around 30 gigaflops. Indeed, it's quite exciting. It's quite complex. You build a model, and you do a spectral synthesis for this so-called Stokes vector, Stokes spectrum, and you compare then with the real observation in your model. And the comparison is by a singular value decomposition. So this is a very complex computing task, and the others also. So maybe you can imagine this is a very dedicated task here. And the Spanish colleagues have implemented there a special process that we see also here. Some parallelism, these are floating point capable processors dedicatedly developed, and some shared processing capabilities with needle functions here in the singular parallel decomposition, also implemented in hardware. So this is a real hardware implementation of a complex algorithm. The side aspect is that these kind of FPGAs, from their package, you don't find a qualified soldering process. Package assembly is a problem. So we had to qualify the package assembly by ourselves for this project. We had to find a soldering process, someone who can do the soldering process in a qualified way, under ESA supervision. That was, I would say, nearly most of the work we had to do with this qualification there. In the end, so this mechanical thermal qualification, all the problems I indicated before, this high thing called MyCs. You see, the result is a very compact GPU. This is roughly 16 by 16 centimeters. Here is the another PCB for the for the memory on board. We have, I think, 4 terabit of memory here. These are the two Xilinx FPGAs, and then we have the Leon processor and the Actel FPGA also placed on this. This is very compact, it's power efficient, consumes less than 16 watts in total, and it comprises a very high floating point performance in a single chip, in one FPGA. So this is in fact really comparable from performance with this very dedicated implementation of this kind of MaxSys processor. So no doubt, also the power efficient. Even if this is an FPGA, which is quite slow, you can achieve clock speeds here of 150 to 200 megahertz or something like this. So not very high clock speeds on the chip itself. But due to the very tailored, very dedicated implementation, you can achieve very high computing performance. So this way with custom design is not too bad for these kind of applications. It's very tailored. What it is obvious, if we would have had a MaxSys processor here, then we could have easily replaced this kind of processing here with a MaxSys processor. But it has been not available. So there's, with this very dedicated instrument processing here, there's one capability for applications. The other example I'd like to show is from the Earth observation domain. It's a hyperspectral instrument I've already addressed. It's a German environmental map and analysis program. It's from the German Space Agency funded hyperspectral instrument. And there we are implementing NTSI, the instrument controller, and the solid state mass memory. And here, the main processing challenge is data compression. We are doing, traditionally, data compression is done such that you put a compressor beforehand in storage. Then you are able to cut down the data stream to a safe memory storage area and adapt it to the downlink. This is okay, but the problem is that typically the data is not in the right order here. You have to reorder the data and so on. You have to do some processing before you can do the compression. So this is all need to be done with the speed of the detectors here, with the detector data rates. This is the classical data flow. What we did here is we said, okay, hey, we have a memory on board. Why don't we store the data as they are and do the reordering and compression later on after storage? That's what we done, and we put a compressor into each memory module. So we have a kind of an intelligent functional module where you have a side compression here with access to the memory. And then you can decide when you do the compression in the orbit, when it fits to you. For instance, when the instrument is not working, you can do it in parallel, but if you save power, you can make a snapshot with the image, with the images, to the memory, and then afterwards you can do the compression, and then if you reach the ground station, you can do the down. So it's an operational sequencing, which is more energy efficient. This is a kind of module. This is the memory controller, and this is the compressor. These are the memory banks. There's several memory banks in each module. And this is a modular approach. You can adapt to data rates by adding modules, adapt capacity by adding modules, and so on. And here again, where is the potential application of the next phase? It is in these intelligent modules. You can put aside the next phase here, think about the fast access to the memory module, and then you can do any type of processing like compression and others in the max space. And you could also think about saving the memory controller here. If you put into the max space the right type of memory controller with has all these mechanisms for failure tolerance, which I pointed out before. So the compression memory module again was built by IDA. this structure, we had two FPGAs, and in principle, if you combine this functionality with the MaxSpace, it would be a nice application for the MaxSpace. You wouldn't need 64 cores, maybe one or two cores, depending on the processing demands, but it would be also a different way of using such a MaxSpace processor, which we already have discussed also with in future mass memory systems. And we have also the booting capability, which is normally not shown here before these modules. The booting capability comes in for free with the MaxSpace. You have a lot of high-speed serial links, so it will ease the interconnection of these modules with the MaxSpace. And some other things here, because of the high data rates, we have a hardware support file system, which can be also done in such a many core processor like MaxSpace. Future extensions, the next idea is to have these hyperspectral instruments, not with a 2D compression, but this is a 3D data cube to optimize the compression, the 3D compression schemes, up to putting in this side way, the image interpretation, like we did in the QI2S project, into such a state processor integrated into the memory module directly. So direct access to the memory by a high performance processor. This is a smart memory module. And to extend a little bit, this is our JUICE module. And this is a kind of smart memory, mass memory module, which we are implementing now for ESA, for the JUICE mission. And there you have the classic On one hand, the classical storage function, which is this here, the science mass memory. And then you have typically in these science missions a bunch of instruments where with different data rates producing data with different demands on data processing. And you could think about using the routing and the processing capabilities of a MaxFace processor to implement this kind of routing node here by such a such a processor. Then you can do instrument-specific processing with the dedicated cores there. So it's all potentially possible, would be potentially possible with the MaxFace processor. At the moment, we are doing that with SpaceWire routers, very dedicatedly hardware, and the MaxFace processor would be much more reconfigurable. Okay. So it's also kind of application, not really in the high performance processor.
So this for the presentation will be divided into an introduction. Then I'll describe a little bit about the data flow diagram that we use. We identified five applications and many subsets of applications. Talk quickly about the ESA benchmarks, and then finally our final selection. So the purpose of this presentation is to show some potential applications that would exploit in the best way possible the MaxFace process, multi-core processor. In order to do that, we defined, we made a common set of needs and requirements, which we translated into a data flow, which I'll show you on the next slide. And then we gathered many different applications, of which we did a kind of trade study, a trade-off on it. In the end, we chose two applications, but all the information that we gathered during this trade-off, we can use for future, the other applications could be used for future studies. So this is the block diagram that we chose. We just needed something common, to have a common interface with all our different applications. And within this block diagram, we basically divided things into the input, the output, the processing, and the external memory. Within the input, we have our overall data throughput or flow, which can be divided into signals and streams. We have the external memory, which is an overall data set size. We have a input data block, which we defined as the block that would be needed by the processor. We have the processing, and then we have the same thing on the output that we do on the input, which I can maybe describe a little better here. Well, the overall data set size, we just needed to have some kind of idea of how much external memory we would need for the processing. The input, and it's the same thing for the output, overall data flow, we defined in terms of individual links, the throughput, and the number of individual links. Each single stream being input or output, we needed to define in terms of throughput, the information, actual bus width size, 10 bits, 16 bits, and then which type of interface we'd be using, a space wire, an ADC input, etc. And then there's the last one, which is the processing. For each processing, we would have to divide it into individual processing steps, and we'd have to figure out what algorithms we would use, FFTs, FERS, etc. And then we'd have to figure out what percentage of the operations will be done in integer, in floating point single precision, or floating point double precision. And so basically we use this this black diagram for all of our studies. It's just a common thing. The applications at top level that we identified were five. The rover, visual navigation, radar applications, GNSS receiver based under assembly, telecom applications, which we probably have the most subsets, and high resolution optical imaging. Okay, the first is the rover visual navigation. The rover configuration is based on our sampling fetching rover study, and we used other heritage from past projects. We broke down the rover visual navigation into three main functions: the guidance, the navigation, and the control. The guidance is just a simple way to establish a safe and optimal path towards the target. The navigation corresponds to figuring out the position and altitude using different algorithms. And the final control is just determining the correct maneuvers to finally guide us to our final destination. Radar applications. We identified four applications that could take advantage of the MaxBase hardware. Radar data compression, digital beamforming, data processing for low resolution systems, and range processing. In the end, we narrowed these down to two: the radar data compression and radar digital beamforming. Well, first I'll talk about the radar data compression. So once the SAR, the radar SAR, has acquired the data, the most important operation is the data compression. It's required to reduce the data to be stored, and then the most important thing is after that we have to transmit it to ground. This acquisition is characterized by a frequency cycle called the pulse repetition frequency. In each of these cycles, the radar transmits an impulse and the samples the received one with a frequency typical of our instrument and band use. And this is just showing you that the acquired data can be shown as a matrix with the azimuth and the range. And there's many different compression algorithms that can be used. We narrowed it down to these three, which is the block adaptive quantization, the flexible dynamic block adaptive quantization, and Bach in the frequency domain, which uses both the FFT and the Bach, which in the end we ended up doing the Bach and the FFT Bach. This is just an overall block diagram of the FFT Bach, which this operation takes in the data acquisition from ADCs, probably at 10 bits. It brings them in, performs a casting operation to bring it to a precision of 32 bits. Then we perform the 2D FFT and can bring it to the transformation of the frequency domain. Then we perform the Bach, which creates the sigma factors and uses the 32, looks at the function of the position to get the final position precision, which is then stored. And as it probably goes down to, at this point, it's 3 bits. The second radar application is digital beamforming. This is just a conceptual idea of the antenna, which in digital beamforming, basically the antenna is divided into many different parts with the azimuth and the elevation. ASA currently is funding a program, Space Situation Awareness, which is basically to control the space situation around Earth. And many new techniques capable of detecting objects from orbiting spacecraft using radar technologies are being studied. One of the most important ones is digital beamforming, DBF. And the principal technique is to acquire simultaneously all the different signals from all the divided parts of how the antenna is divided. And then simultaneously you need to process them. This is another application for the radar. Again, just a very high level conceptual block diagram of the GNSS. it's dependent on its wider bandwidth or narrow bandwidth is the next process. Basically, this follows a classic heterodyne technique. The wideband signals are mixed with the synthesized carrier at or near the carrier frequency of the channel interest and work to channel baseband. The resulting signal is then filtered and decimated to isolate and extract the channel of interest from the wideband signal and reduce the overall sample rate to the minimum necessary to be defined. Two different types of filtering and decimation techniques can then be employed. One for the wider bandwidth signals, which requires a decimation of 8 or less. And a fair filter is utilized directly from the baseband mixer. The output of this filter is then decimated by the appropriate amount. Or for the narrowband signals, the filtering and decimation functions are typically split into multiple stages. Continuing with the DDC part of the module, the channelization design allows processing of up to 8 RF bandwidth in parallel, all with SIS required in parallel. The bandwidth for the signals should then be tunable, and adopting the wideband DDC for each of the GNSS signals can be processed with three items. You find this the DDS frequency for filter design, and the N&M destination factor. The selected destination factors are the 8, 4, and 3 with the following N frequencies. Now we move on to another general application, which this application is probably the most subsets, is the telecom operation. In space technology for telecommunications, SATCOM, there are basically three main technology improvements which are currently in progress, and they cover three critical areas. Improvement in the antenna architectural area, improvement in payload subsystems in the components area, and finally improvement in the payload system architecture area. These improvements are required on one hand by the current application exigencies of the service, and on the other side by the SATCOM operators, which are mainly commercial, but they're followed closely by a military and institutional. The following capabilities are required from the MaxSpace MiniCore DSP to support operations within the SATCOM. So we basically looked at the MaxSpace and said we needed to do this for our telecom operations in general. The execution of digital signal processing in order to maintain an extended degree of onboard flexibility. The capability to be combined with other technologies to cope with some evolutionary requirements such as fast memory access, high I/O throughput, supporting up to 500 megahertz, high degree of parallelization and computation efficiency for our routines, FFT, decoders, decoders, etc. And a digital processing module with the core element on interfaces to ADCs, DACs, and other external memories. Okay, one subset of the telecom application is a high throughput satellite mission, which is HTS. And this requires an onboard computation that is very challenging, which we hope the MaxSpace could deliver. This the HTS systems manage broadband bidirectional communication satellite networks. These systems serve the users via more than 200 beams, each with 500 megahertz in the Ka band, with the four-color reuse pattern, with a constant very high frequency reuse factor. If there's any questions, you just stop me. Example of the HTS is the Public Protection and Disaster Relief mission. And this is basically the service areas of global satellite coverage made of a set of theaters complemented by scattered spot beams. And in particular, this focuses on post-crisis support, where the rescue workers would need communication services, internet services, broadcasting, messaging, data casting. These services need to be dependable, secure and high level availability, and they need to be set up in time less than 10 minutes. Most of these user terminals in this situation are nomadic. They're very transportable and easy to pick up. Another of HTS is the bi-direction satellite data service. And this mission would cover the following cases. High multi-beam coverage satellite architectures based on K-band frequency. Range for the user feeder link, such as the KSAT system operated by Eutelsat. Another is a high multi-beam coverage satellite architecture, which is represented mainly by the HTS systems foreseen to operate the K-band on the user segment side and the KAPV band on the feeder link side. In performing the second frame of activity, several technology must be considered if the 10 allows suitable for the dual polarization multi-beam coverage. This must guarantee an efficient spatial coverage and resource reallocation depending on the operator request in relation to the user and resource needs. The available technologies implementing this kind of capability are based on reconfigurable antennas, adopting several technical approaches that can be combined with a repeater, with the flexibility such as mechanical reconfigurable passive antennas, electronically reconfigurable passive antennas, active antennas, high and very high density dual polarization feed clusters, and array feed reflector antennas, and direct radiated array antennas. At the repeater level, two main elements need to be considered: frequency and bandwidth configurability and the onboard signal routing capability. This is performed at the repeater level and gives the possibility to route the signals from the RX section to the transmitting section of the TLC payload. And this gives the possibility to implement the frequency reuse approach, supported also with coverage. Another application within telecom applications are mobile satellite services for aeronautical and UAV communications. UAV is the unmanned air vehicle, which would include command and control, which would require data, air traffic control, data and voice, and sense and avoidance, which is just data. The UAV are used for mainly military applications, but they're also soon expected to be widely used for civilian applications in homeland security, land management, earth science, etc. The UAV range can span from a few kilometers to tens of thousands of kilometers under global coverage. Another subset is of the telecom application is the anti-interference, anti-jamming with commercial SATCOM. Suitable performing OBP capabilities are required for this new and challenging mission scenario. A typical commercial broadcasting satellite service, BDS, and a fixed satellite service based on multi-beam coverage where nullity capabilities required to counteract involuntary and voluntary the jamming interference, causing a loss of revenues for the SATCOM operator. Typically, the commercial SATCOM are not really protected, they're not hardened against the unintentional, the true interference, or the intentional, the jamming interference. But at the same time, the growing request of these services and application field is increasing the efficiency of the satellite operators to guarantee a high level and constant level of service. And within this, the anti-interference and jamming, we need to provide the commercial market something, but we have to keep in mind the trade-off between the effectiveness, the performance, and the implementation costs. In a detailed detailed description, the anti-interference and anti-jamming technique is based on a multi-beam antenna system driven by a suitable onboard beamforming network managed by a powerful onboard processing subsystem, which will hopefully be the next phase. This means a guarantee of ground coverage that supplies the traffic and the capability to reconfigure the antenna spots, which would implement more nodes at ground to isolate interference sources located in the coverage area. This is just an overall block there, the diagram of the anti-interference and jamming. On the top is the system, the noise system that would be in space, and on the bottom would be the ground segment. Another subset application of the telecom is the IP routing for onboard satellites, which has become more important. And so another thing that the next phase could help us with, technology could help us with, would be a big improvement represented by the possibility to integrate onboard on the payload a complete IP router working at the ISO level. This would be capable to manage the routing as in the terrestrial internet access, driving IP services such as data, voice, and IP-based high-definition video. The implementation of this IP router on board could improve the space segment efficiency by providing direct on-the-sky capability to route IP traffic. This would shortcut the necessity to land any traffic at ground level at hubs or gateways before accessing the space segment. And moreover, the data traffic throughput can be improved, reducing latency and enabling flexible bandwidth on-demand applications. Another slide in the IP routing. If extending this IP routing network into space would also allow the improvement in creating a seamless global satellite network, shown below, supporting a continuous continuity of operations for emergency communications in the crisis areas and also in mobile conditions such as military fields. This capability can be further increased integrating the IP access of overall IP ground network infrastructure, wired or wireless. Slide on the IP, this can get some detail. The mission case for a network operations center is necessary to configure the onboard routing system, managing the OS policy, security features, and the router protocols, and the satellite anti-jamming levels and other capabilities supporting processing on board. Currently, the IP traffic has extended its access also to the satellite links using several technologies and modes, but without an effective routing, onboard routing. At the ground level, or at the user terminal level or hub station, the IP is encapsulated in specific satellite access protocols such as the DVB-RCS and DVB-2, and then delivered towards the satellite. These systems constitute a first step in enhancing flexibility in terms of connectivity scenarios supporting the IP. However, they also represent some constraints and limitations. Indeed, with these translucent payloads, they offer quasi-static connectivity for a limited number of beams under the user's network control center connected scheme. However, this solution is poorly adapted to an increasing number of IP users that generate unpredictable traffic profiles. The satellite payload based on the onboard processing seems to be a suitable solution to maximize flexibility requirements and at the same time introduce other limitations of satellite payload related to the foreseen specific standards of layer 2 and layer 3, such as the ATM, MPEG, and IPv4. Another critical point is the complexity of the onboard processing solutions in terms of processing, mass, and power levels. A conceptual block diagram of not all, but most of the telecom operations. Marx, and there's the modular designation, the processing, the modulation, continuous multiplexing, and at the back end, the output going to the DAC and DAC. The last application that we initially looked at for the next pitch processor was could be used in high resolution optical imaging. The instruments and associated processing tunes that we need to consider were composed of three elements: detectors, compression, and storage. Depending on the mission, the instrument can include any different number of detectors from 4 to 10. Each of these detectors, 4 data lines were generated at about 1 to 1.2 gigabytes per second data rate, each carrying different types of images. These images were subject to pre-processing and comprehension separately. And the 4 resulted compression images are forwarded to the data storage unit. They could be forwarded on separate links or more efficiently, separate links at about 400 to 500 megabits per second, or more efficiently multiplexed onto a signal link, which would be 1.5 to 2 gigabytes per second. The compression that we used was according to the wavelet algorithm, and the pre-processing consisted of banding, the deposition, and the pixel realignment. This brings us to the last, next to last chapter, which is kind of preceding tomorrow's presentation. In 2008, ESA furnished a document for some benchmarking signal processing software, which we decided to use. In this software benchmark, they broke it down into 5 different cases, labeled B1 to B5. The first is I/O performance. The second, analog data acquisition, processing the output, the throughput. The third is image data compression and packaging. And the fourth and fifth are 2 different data processing cases, case 1 and case 2. Case 1 being application, the acquisition of optical remote sensing science data. And the second case, for processing the microwave radar remote sensing science data. I don't know, Ben, if you could talk a little bit about each of these terms. The first steps for the digital beamform application. from the GNSS RX application, we chose to implement an SFC module, which looked like a good candidate, and this would allow us to explore the maximum number of channels, which can be managed by a single MAC space. From the HR Ops of imaging, we thought this would be a good case to cover the ASIC benchmark B3. We could add the acquisition of data from the